Hello everyone, welcome to our YouTube channel Jai Shri Javaji. Today we shall continue to start reading the chapters of the book Wings of Fire by Amit Tiwari, part 5. If I was not flying aeroplanes, I was at least helping to make them airworthy. During my first year in directorate, I carried out a design assignment on supersonic target aircraft with the help of the office in charge, R. Varadarajan, and won a word of praise from the director, Dr. Neelakantan. To gain shop floor exposure to aircraft maintenance, I was sent to the Aircraft and Armament Testing Unit, ANATU, at Kanpur. At that time, they were involved in the evaluation of NATMK, an aircraft. I participated in the performance assessment of its operation systems. Even in those days, Kanpur was a very popular city, my first experience of living in an industrial town. The cold weather, crowds, noise and smoke were in total contrast to what I used to in Rameshwaram. I was particularly troubled by the ubiquitous presence of potatoes on the dining table, right from breakfast to dinner. To me, it seemed that a feel of loneliness pervaded the city. The people on the streets had all come from the villages in search of job factories, leaving behind the smell of their soil in protection of their families. On my return to Delhi, I was informed that the design of a DART target had been taken up at the DTDNP Air and that I had been included in the design team. I completed this task with the other team members and I undertook a preliminary design study on a human centrifuge. I later carried out the design and development of a vertical takeoff and landing platform. I was also associated with the development and construction of the hot cockpit. 3 years passed, then the Aeronautical Development Established, ADE, was born in Bangalore and I was posted to the new establishment. Bangalore as a city was in direct contrast to Kanpur. In fact, I feel our country has an uncanny way of bringing out extremes in her people. I suppose it is because Indians have been both afflicted and enriched by centuries of migration. Loyalty to different rulers had ruled, dulled our capacity for a single allegiance. Instead, we have developed an extraordinary ability to be compassionate and cruel, sensitive and callous, deep and fickle at all the time. To the untrained eye, we may appear colorful and picturesque. To the critical eye, we are but shoddy limitations of our various masters. In Kanpur, I saw pan-chewing imitators of Wajid's Ali Shah, and in Bangalore, it was replaced by dog-walking sahibs. Here too, I longed for the depth and calmness of Rameshwaram. The relationship between the heart and the head of the earthy Indian has been eroded by the divided sensibilities of our cities. I spent my evening exploring the gardens and shopping plazas of Bangalore. The workload at ADA during the first year of its inception was quite light. In fact, I had to generate work for myself at first, until the tempo gradually built up. Based on my preliminary studies on ground handling equipment, a project team was formed to design and develop an indigenous hovercraft prototype as a ground equipment machine, GEM. The team was a small working group comprising 4 persons at the level of scientific assistant. Dr. O.P. Medirattar, director of ADA, asked me to lead the team. We were given 3 years to launch the engineering model. The project was by standards bigger than our collective capabilities. None of us had any experience in building a machine, let alone a flying machine. There were no designs or standard components available to begin with. All we knew was that we had to make a successful heavier-than-air flying machine. We tried to read as much as literature as we could find on hovercrafts, but there was not much available. We tried to consult people knowledgeable in this area, but could find none. One day I simply took the decision to proceed with the limited information and resources available. This endeavor to produce a wingless, light, swift machine opened the windows of my mind. I was quickly at least a metaphorical connection between a hovercraft and an aircraft. After all, the Wright brothers made the first aeroplane after fixing bicycles for 7 years. I saw in the GEM project great opportunities for ingenuity and growth. We went straight into hardware development after spending a few months on the drawing board. There is always the danger that a person with my kind background, rural, small town, middle class, whose parents had limited education, will retreat into a corner and remain there struggling for basic existence, unless a turn of circumstances propels him into a more favorable environment. I knew I had to create my own opportunities. Part by part, subsystem by subsystem, stage by stage, things started moving. Working on this project, I learned that once your mind stretches to a new level, it never goes back to its original dimension. At that time, V.K. Krishna Menon was the defense minister. He was keenly interested in the progress of a project which he envisioned as the beginning of indigenous development of India's defense equipment. Whenever he was in Bangalore, he always found some time to review the progress of our project. His confidence in ability ignited our enthusiasm. I would enter the assembly shop, leaving my other problems outside. Just my father used to enter the mosque for prayer, leaving his shoes outside. but not everyone accepted Krishnamenon's opinion about GEM. Our experiments with the available parts and components did not exactly delight my senior colleagues. Many even called us a group of eccentric inventors in pursuit of an impossible dream. I begin the leader of the navvies was a particularly inviting target. I was regarded as yet another country bumpkin who believed that riding the air was his domain. The weight of opinion against us was buttressed by our optimistic mind. The comments of some of the senior scientists at ADE made me recall John Trowbridge's famous satirical poem on the Wright brothers published in 1896. With thimble and thread and wax and hammer and buckles and screws and all such things as geniuses use. Two bats for patterns, curious fellows, a charcoal pot and a pair of bellows. When the project was about a year old, Defense Minister Krishnamenon made one of his routine visits to ADE. I escorted him into our assembly shop. Inside on a table lay the GEM model broken down into sub-assemblies. The model represented the culmination of 1 year's untiring efforts to develop a practical hovercraft for battlefield applications. The minister fired one question after another at me, determined to ensure that the prototype would go into the test flight within the coming year. He told Dr. Medirat that GEM flight is possible with the gadgets Kalam now possesses. The hovercraft was christened Nandi, after the bull ridden by Lord Shiva. For a prototype, its form, fit and finish was beyond our expectation, given the rudimentary infrastructure we possessed. I told my colleagues, here is a flying machine not constructed by a bunch of crap, but by engineers of ability. Don't look at it. It is not made to look at, but to fly with. Defense Minister Krishnamenon flew in the Nandi, overruling the accompanying officials' concern for his safety. A group captain in the minister's troop, who had logged in many thousands of flying hours, even offered to fly the mission to save the minister from the potential danger of flying with an inexperienced civilian pilot like myself, and gestured to me to come out of the mission. I was sure about my competence in flying the mission ahead of me, and therefore shook my head in negation. Observing this wordless communication, Krishnamenon dismissed the insulting suggestion of the group captain with a laugh and signaled to me to start the mission. He was very happy. You have demonstrated that the basic problems of hovercraft development are solved. Go for a more powerful prime mover and call me for a second ride, Krishnamenon told me. The skeptical group captain, Air Marshal Gole, later became a good friend of mine. We completed the project ahead of schedule. We had a working hovercraft with us, moving on an air cushion of about 40 mm with a load of 50 kg, including the tire weight. Dr. Mediratta was visibly pleased with the achievement, but by this time Krishnamenon was out of office and could not take his promised second ride. In the new order, many people shared his grim with regard to military applications of an indigenous hovercraft. In fact, even today, we import hovercrafts. The project was mired in controversies and was finally shelved. It was a new experience for me. So far, I had believed that the sky was the limit, but it appeared that the limits were much closer. There are boundaries that dictate life. You can only lay so much weight. You can only learn so fast. You can only work so hard. You can only go so far. I was unwilling to face reality. I had put my heart and soul into Nandi, but it would not be used something beyond my comprehension. I was disappointed and disillusioned. In this period of confusion and uncertainty, memories from my childhood came back to me and I discovered new meanings in Paksha Sastri used to say, seek the truth and the truth shall set you free. As the Bibles ask and you shall receive. It did not happen immediately, but it happened nevertheless. One Dr. Medirakta called me. He inquired about the state of our hovercraft. When told that it was in perfect condition to be flown, he asked me to organize a demonstration for an important visitor the next day. No VP was scheduled to visit the laboratory during the next week, as far as I knew. However, I communicated Dr. Mediratta's instructions to my colleagues and we felt a new surge of hope. The next day, Dr. Mediratta brought a visitor to our hovercraft, a tall, handsome, bearded man. He asked me several questions about the mission. I was struck by the objectivity and clarity of his thinking. Can you give me a guide in the mission? He inquired. His request filled me with joy. Finally, here was someone who was interested in my work. We took a 10-minute ride in hovercraft, a few centimeters above the ground. We were not flying, but definitely floating in the air. The visitor asked me a few questions about myself, thanked me for the ride, and departed. But not before introducing himself, he was Professor M.G. Kemenon, Director of Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. After a week, I received a call from the Indian Committee for Space Research to attend an interview for the post of Rocket Engineer. All I knew about IncoSpar at that time was that it was formed out of the TIFR talent pool at Bombay, now Mumbai, to organize space research in India. I went to Bombay to attend the interview. I was unsure about the type of questions I would have to face at the interview. There was hardly any time to read up or talk to any experienced person. Lakshmana Shastri's voice quote from the Bhagavad Gita echoed in my ears. All beings are born to delusion, overcome by the dualities which arise from wish and hate. But those men of virtuous deeds in whom sin has become to an end, freed from the delusion of dualities, worship me steadfast in their works. I reminded myself that the best way to win was to not need to win. The best performances are accomplished when you are released, relaxed and free of doubt. I decided to take things as they came. Since neither Professor M.G.K. Menon's visit nor the call for an interview had been of my making, I decided this was the best attitude to take. I was introduced, interviewed by Dr. Vikram Sarabhai along Professor M.G.K. Menon and Mr. Saraf, then the Deputy Secretary of the Atomic Energy Commission. As I entered, I sensed their warmth and friendliness. I was almost immediately struck by Dr. Sarabhai's. There was none of arrogance or the patronizing attitudes which interviewers usually display when talking to a young and vulnerable candidate. Dr. Sarabhai's questions did not probe my existing knowledge or skills, rather they were an exploration of the possibilities I was filled with. He was looking at me as if in reverence to a larger whole. The entire encounter seemed to me a total moment of truth in which my dream was enveloped by the larger dream of a bigger person. I was advised to stay back for a couple of days. However, the next evening I was told about my selection. I was to be observed as a rocket engineer at Inkos Park. This was a breakthrough a young man like myself dreamed of. My work at Inkos Park commenced with a familiarization course at TIFR Computer Center. The atmosphere here was remarkably different from that at DTP, DTD and PA. Labels mattered very little. There was no need for anyone to justify his position or to be at the receiving end of others' hostility. Sometime in the later half of 1962, Inkos Park took the decision to set up the Equatorial Rocket Launching Station at Tumba, a sleepy fishing village near Trivandrum, now Thiruvananthapuram in Kerala. Dr. Chitney's of Physical Research Laboratory, Ahmedabad, had spotted it as a suitable location as it was very close to the Earth's magnetic equator. This was the quiet beginning of modern rocket-based research in India. The site selected at Tumba lay between the railway line and the sea coast, covering a distance of about 2.5 kilometers, measuring about 600 acres. Within this area stood a large church whose site has to be acquired. Land acquisition from private parties is always a difficult and time-consuming process, especially in densely populated places like Kerala. In addition, there was the delicate matter of acquiring a site of religious significance. The collector of Trivandrum, then K. Madhavan Nair, executed this task in a most tactful, peaceful and expeditious manner with the blessings and cooperation of Right Rev. Dr. Derera, who was the Bishop of Trivandrum in 1962. Soon, R. D. John, the executive engineer of the Central Public Works Department, had transformed the entire area. The St. Mary Magdalene Church housed the first office of the Tumba Space Center. The prayer room was my first laboratory. The bishop's room was my design and drawing office. To this day, the church is maintained in its full glory and at present houses the Indian Space Museum. Very soon after this, I was asked to proceed to America for a six-month training program on a sounding rocket launching techniques at the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, NASA, work centers. I took some time off before going abroad and went to Rameshwaram. My father was very pleased to learn about the opportunity that had come my way. He took me to the mosque and organized a special namaz in thanksgiving. I could feel the power of God flowing in a circuit through my father to me and back to God. We were all under the spell of prayer. One of the important functions of prayer, I believe, is to act as a stimulus to creative ideas. Within the mind are all the resources required for successful living. Ideas are present in consciousness, which when released and given scope to grow and take shape can lead a successful life. God, our creator, had stored within our minds and personalities great potential, strength and ability. Prayers help us to tap and develop these powers. Ahmed Jalaluddin and Samsuddin came to see me at Bombay airport. It was their first exposure to big city like Bombay, just as I myself was about to have my first exposure to mega city like New York. Jalaluddin and Samsuddin were brilliant, positive, optimistic men who undertook their work with the assurance of success. It is in these two persons that I drew the core creative power of my mind. My sentiments could not be contained and I could feel the mist of tears in my eyes. Then Jalaluddin said, Azad, we always loved you and believe in you. We shall always be proud of you. The intensity and purity of their faith in my capabilities broke my last defenses and tears welled up in my eyes. Okay all, let's end up for today. We shall continue to start reading the chapters of the book Wings of Fire. Thank you for continuously listening to our recordings. Have a great day.